Okay, well, let me welcome everybody. This is a class in the Marxian sense divided audience. We need to sort of get our schedule in order. And that is that this is the core of the people who are sitting here are Professor Esposito's class. And their agenda is that they will be, from now until 3:30, here with all of the rest of us and being enlightened on God's century. And then at 3:30, anybody who isn't in Professor Esposito's class will be asked to leave. Tim and Monica will also be leaving to go and do some interviews. And so that becomes then the class division. The elite class gets to stay with Melanie, and the rest of us proletarian laborers will go and do something else. But that's our kind of schedule. My name is John Ball. I'm the associate director of the Prince Albert Elite Center, and I'd like to welcome those of you who are not in the class, and I didn't want to make you necessarily feel like unnecessary adjuncts, but welcome anyway. We have a very interesting and important kind of discussion, and it's one of those things where I like to remind people there are only maybe a couple of us in the room that can remember a day when this kind of discussion would have been impossible. Nobody in their right mind 50 years ago would have written a book about the importance of religion for global politics. That would have been such a no-brainer of a turndown from any editor, because everybody knew, of course, that religion was no longer, 50 years ago, that religion was no longer an important element in society, in politics. And I can remember there was, in the late 60s, there was a large conference of sociologists of religion. And the title of the conference was, "What Will Be the Nature of Religionless Society?" And now, part of the transformation, 100 years ago, there was a very optimistic social gospel Christian, Protestant Christian magazine that was founded that saw the world through the framework of liberal Protestant Christianity, and the magazine is still in operation, but it was called the Christian Century. And the 20th century, in their view, was going to be the Christian Century. And now we're at the beginning of the 21st century, and we are looking forward to being told how this is not the Christian Century necessarily, but it's God's Century. And we have with us today one of those really good examples of the grand networking of our scholarly community dealing with the study of religion. Monica Duffy Toft and Tim Shah are people who, as you look at all of the details of their bios, it shows you that institutional scholarly identification now is a fluid networking. And you look at Monica's networking, I mean, she is currently Associate Professor of Public Policy at the John F. Kennedy School at Harvard, but her institutional identities in the past and present give us a network of all of those new institutions that have been interested in the study of religion in contemporary affairs, and she is one of the foremost experts in the country in this area. And Tim Shah, again, already is sitting with us with two appointments, one here and one out in the Midwest. And in basketball, we won't mention in favor of basketball amity. At least the Notre Dame basketball team isn't like the Chinese military and tries to jump and kick on our people. Tim is associate director of the Religious Freedom Project at the Berkeley Center here at Georgetown, and is a visiting professor here at Georgetown, and is a research professor at Notre Dame's Kroc Institute as well. I'm looking very much forward to hearing what we are getting in full explanation and discussion in the book God Century, The Resurgent Religion and Global Politics. In contrast to a lot of book discussions, we don't have somebody sitting outside who can sell you a book, but there is an exhibit over at the bookstore. If you want to pick up the book, you can get it there. So, welcome Monica, welcome Tim. I guess, Tim, are you going to go first?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
So, and when he gets done talking, then Monica will start, yeah. Mm-hmm. And there will be time for questions and comments, unless they talk until 3:30. Mm-hmm. And so, welcome, and I'm looking forward to our session together.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that very kind introduction, Professor Vohl. As you may know, if you've seen God Century, this is a book that's a product of three authors, and we first have to say that we're sorry that our colleague and co-author and friend Dan Philpott could not be here as well. Dan has instructed us to say that, of course, he bears no responsibility for anything stupid that we might say in the course of today's lecture and discussion. I think he's also told us that he assumes full responsibility for anything intelligent or groundbreaking we might say in the course of today. So we just wanted to make that absolutely clear. Anyway, it's something like that. But we're sorry that Dan can't be with us. Well, we first want to begin with a confession. We're political scientists, and we regret to say that the view of global politics taught by political scientists, by we political scientists, which we ourselves have taught, operated in, which we ourselves have been instructed into, is, we're afraid to say, the poorest possible preparation for the era of global politics in which we now live. As PhD students in political science at Harvard some 20 years ago, two of the authors of this book, myself and the previously named Dan Philpott, had to take an introductory course in comparative world politics. And the first book we distinctly remember reading in that course was a book I'm sure Professor Vohl is familiar with, called The Passing of Traditional Society by Daniel Lerner. This was a classic study of the coming of modernity, a book that was so influential it's hard even to sort of exaggerate how important it was. It was about the coming of modernity, modern values, modern education, modern organizations, and how the juggernaut of modernity was revolutionizing the traditional cultures and societies of the Middle East. Reading that book in the early 1990s, and as I say, it was the very first book, it was sort of strategically placed at the beginning of our syllabus, I recall vividly Lerner's sweeping conclusion about what modernity would mean for religion and traditional culture and for Islam in particular. Lerner concluded that Islam in the Middle East is, quote, and I'm quoting, absolutely defenseless in the face of the rationalist and positivist spirit of modernity. The modernization, urbanization, and industrialization of Egypt and other Arab countries in the Middle East would sweep aside religion and tradition and would bring about the secularization of Egypt and the countries of the Middle East. Well, I don't know, I guess we can't know for sure, how many of our graduate school classmates went on to work in the State Department or the Defense Department or the RAND Corporation or the White House or Capitol Hill, but we know that some of them went on to jobs in government, and some of them went on to jobs as professors of political science at major universities like us. But wherever they went, the view of global politics in which they were immersed, in which we were immersed, was, we're sorry to say again, the poorest possible preparation for the era of global politics in which we now live. The era we call in our book God Century, Resurgent Religion and Global Politics. All of our Harvard classmates, and in Monica Toft's case, University of Chicago classmates who entered, say, the State Department, had lots of political economy, lots of political sociology, lots of international security, lots of theories of democratization crammed into their heads. And they were well prepared to analyze almost any conceivable global political problem, almost any conceivable global political issue. But the one thing they did not have crammed into their heads was any understanding of religion or culture, even any expectation that religion or culture might be important factors in shaping global politics. Though Islam was supposed to be absolutely defenseless in the face of modernity, here we are today, mesmerized, dumbfounded, fascinated by the events of the current Arab Spring. Right now, in country after country, the central issue is what kinds of regimes, what kinds of systems, and societies will come next, now that so many authoritarian lids have been blown off, from Egypt to Libya, from Yemen to Bahrain. And in all these cases, whatever the outcomes may be, the various Islamic groups and other religious groups flooding into the political foreground are going to have a major impact on determining the future of these societies. As we grapple with the central issue of what the future in the Middle East will look like, a central task becomes understanding precisely what some of our most influential social scientists told us was supposed to be absolutely defenseless: religion, tradition, and in particular, Islam. In other words, as we address some of our most central geopolitical challenges, we don't have the luxury of averting our eyes from the details of religion, religious actors, religious institutions, religious ideas. What is their real organizational capacity? What are their real political intentions? What are their theologies of politics? What is their religious inspiration? What were their religious influences? What is their religious agenda? Of course, religious groups like the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, the Islam Party in Yemen, these groups may not always be leading the pro-freedom charge in the Middle East today. They may not always be at the vanguard of the political action. And yet still, the religious leanings of the masses have been visible almost everywhere. As, for example, when the conservative Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi addressed the praying crowds of Egyptians in Tahrir Square at that enormous victory rally on February 18th of this year. He praised the, quote, youth of the revolution, which, quote, has lifted the head of this country and made us proud once again. And he called the young people who made the revolution, quote, the new partisans of God. Sheikh Qardawi was right. Demonstrably religious young people, very open about their religious backgrounds, beliefs, identities, Muslims and Coptic Christians alike, were very much partisans of God in their consistent invocation of religious slogans, signs, and symbols. It was these religious people who, rather than having been secularized by the revolution of modernity in the way Daniel Lerner predicted, actually made a political revolution that our secular, sophisticated political science did not anticipate. And this revolution raises questions for which our secular policy frameworks have few, if any, answers. On the contrary, our policy frameworks condition us to believe either that groups such as the Muslim Brotherhood do not matter, that they're irrelevant, that they belong to the superstructure of society and politics, or that such groups are an utterly alien and abnormal and dangerous force that should make us panic. It's either one or the other. They're either dangerous or completely irrelevant. Which is to say that we, along with all of our Harvard and Chicago-trained classmates, were rendered far worse than ignorant by the political science in which we were instructed. It's not just that religion was not on the syllabus. It is that we were trained to think that religion could not matter. Our dominant paradigms, the normal political science, to use the phrase of Thomas Kuhn when he talks about normal science and the structure of scientific revolutions, the normal political science in which we were trained pre-screened religion out of the picture as powerless, as something that would just roll over in the face of modernity, and therefore as something that required no theoretical or practical attention whatsoever. The century that our political science was preparing us for was anything but God's century, but rather was supposed to look like the last century, only more so. A 20th century, as Daniel Lerner and so many others suggested, in which religion was put on the defensive by modern forces, movements, and ideologies. In many ways, that century, the 20th century, really did look like one in which the world's most cutting-edge and consequential political forces were anything but self-proclaimed partisans of God. On the contrary, in the 20th century, the cutting-edge agents and actors sweeping global politics often looked like the opposite of self-proclaimed partisans of God and were far more frequently the self-proclaimed enemies of God. Not the partisans of God, but the enemies of God. That may sound like an exaggeration, but if we recall the 20th century, it's really not. Consider an example. Consider Mexican politician Tomas Garrido Canabal. In many ways, Tomas Canabal was an apt symbol of 20th century politics. In the mid-1920s, about 10 years after the radically anti-clerical Mexican Revolution, Canabal became the governor of the state of Tabasco in the south of Mexico. He made it such an important plank of his political platform to rid Tabasco of what he called, quote, clerical opium, that he made it illegal in his state to wear a crucifix, and he also made it illegal to say adios, because adios, of course, has Dios in it. He even proudly handed out little calling cards. This is my favorite part of his biography. He handed out little calling cards that described himself, quote, underneath his name, the personal enemy of God. A habit that would have limited his networking opportunities, I would have thought. But he was a man of strong conviction. Tomas Cannibal, personal enemy of God. Though this sounds outlandish, it's a pretty good example of political ideologies and trends that became increasingly common and influential in global politics. From the time of the anti-clerical French Revolution of 1789 until these movements became largely a spent force politically by the time of the pro-clerical Iranian Revolution of 1979. Beginning in the 19th century, secularist movements and ideologies were more the norm than the exception in world politics, and they swept over every part of the world in the 20th century, peaking in influence and reach between 1917 approximately and 1967 approximately, during that 50-year period in the middle of the 20th century. Lenin's Bolshevik Revolution, Ataturk's Turkish Revolution, the Mexican Revolution, Mao's Cultural Revolution, Nasser's Pan-Arab Revolution, the Shah of Iran's White Revolution, the viciously anti-religious Cambodian Revolution. The list goes on and on of ideologies and movements that were successful, at least for a time, in attacking or marginalizing or weakening the power of religion in their societies in virtually every region of the world. Even in the United States, various cultural, legal, and political forces worked together to promote a kind of secular separationism that exerted a powerful influence from the 1920s when fundamentalist movements went into abeyance in the United States until about the 1970s when fundamentalist movements and other religious movements began to come back. Indeed, the success of these political enemies of God helped to make it more than plausible that secularization really was the wave of the future. They made it seem that religion was a dying supernova, enjoying its penultimate glow before disappearing from history. They made it easily forgivable to think of the 20th century as the godless century, at least as far as politics was concerned, making it increasingly common to ask whether God was dead. That's what I'm trying to show. Making it increasingly common to ask whether God was dead, as Time magazine famously did on its cover in April 1966. They made it possible to view religion as absolutely defenseless in the face of modernity, to quote Daniel Lerner again. Today, however, most of these political ideologies and movements are a spent force, if they're remembered at all. Today, the politics of secularization has less of the world in its grip than perhaps in any time since the early 19th century. Yet if the politics of secularization, of secular movements, ideologies, parties, has gone into steep decline, the theory of secularization, the paradigm of secularization, still is remarkably stubborn, still has many, many minds in its grip. There is evidence that it still has much of the U.S. foreign policy establishment, trained at lingering bastions of secularization theory, very much in its grip. Indeed, it should be no surprise that after a generation of political scientists was trained to ignore religion, our current diplomacy takes a similarly myopic approach. On February 10th, for example, Director of National Intelligence, still the current Director of National Intelligence, James Clapper, told the Congressional Committee that the Islamic Brotherhood is a, quote, largely secular organization. With equal glibness, other analysts have declared the Brotherhood a scary sect waiting to establish a violent theocracy. And yet others just can't think calmly or coherently at all when any kind of religion or religious movement appears on the horizon. When the Washington Post's David Ignatius was in Tahrir Square for that February 18th victory rally that I mentioned a moment ago, he found the mere sight of ordinary Egyptians staging mass prayers, quote, unnerving. That's what he reported in the Washington Post. In God's century, we argue that if American foreign policymakers want to promote democracy and stability, they must come to realize that this kind of approach is a very poor approach indeed, either analytically or in terms of framing policy. The great surprise of the past generation of global politics is a resurgence of religion's political influence across the world. Despite a powerful array of secularizing regimes, ideologies, and social trends, the self-proclaimed partisans of God outlasted and politically outcompeted almost all of the self-proclaimed enemies of God. Part of what happened here is that being a determined enemy of God, like Tomas Cannibal, just didn't turn out to be the growth industry it was supposed to be. Agnostics, atheists, the non-religious thought that they were the wave of the future. But according to respected religion demographer Todd Johnson, the proportion of the world's population that was atheist or agnostic, though it increased for much of the 20th century, then went into a decline around 1970. I think we have a slide on that. Atheists did pretty well up until about 1970, but and agnostics, actually this is agnostics, we've got another slide on atheists. There's atheists about the same. In terms of the sheer number of religious adherents, too, the world's largest religions have expanded at a rate that exceeds that of global population. This shows figures from 1900 projected into 2025, a proportion of the world's population that's Catholic, Protestant, Muslim, Hindu, Buddhist. Around 1900, little more than 50% of the world's population belonged to one of those large religious groupings. Now, around 2000, it went up to 70%, projected to be almost three quarters by 2025. In other words, more of the world's population belongs to one of these large religious communities today than was the case at the beginning of the 20th century. Again, even after so much of what was supposed to be unstoppable secularization. The Muslim Brotherhood stands as a perfect example of a group that defied all expectations. It's a religiously based organization, of course, not the secular organization of James Clapper's imagination, one that faced decades of harsh repression and really seemed finished in the late 1960s. The great scholar of Egypt and the Muslim Brotherhood, Richard Mitchell, in the late 1960s predicted that the Muslim Brotherhood in the future would be but a footnote, a forgotten footnote at that, in any comprehensive history of Egypt, and that from a very sensitive and well-informed analyst of Egyptian religion and politics. And yet, where are we today? Today, the Muslim Brotherhood represents perhaps as much as 15 to 20% of the Egyptian people, perhaps even more. Nor is the Brotherhood an isolated case. Communities of faith everywhere, Buddhist monks in Burma, Hindu nationalists in India, Pentecostals in Brazil, in Nigeria, evangelical Protestants in the United States are playing a critical role in defining the dominant patterns of world politics in the unfolding 21st century. Well, how did this happen? How do we explain the fact that we were so wrong about the dominant trends in religion and politics? We argue in God's Century that, ironically, the resurgence of religion has been empowered by the very trends that secularization predicted would bury religion. The very forces that secularization theory thought would eliminate religion from the scene have actually strengthened religion. The first is modernization. Religion was supposed to wither as people became more modern, more educated, more socialized into an industrialized urban society in which each individual would exercise control over his or her fate. In 1968, for example, the great sociologist of religion, Peter Berger, predicted that communities of faith would dwindle and that the religious faithful would be left isolated, quote, huddled together in small sects to resist a worldwide secular culture. 30 years later, Peter Berger was honest enough to admit that he had been wrong, and he retracted his thesis. It's now clear that even among people in advanced industrialized countries, especially the United States, even some other countries, more than 60% claim that religion remains important to them, even in countries such as Germany, Italy, Ireland, Canada, religion has proven far more resilient than many people predicted. A second trend is globalization. People and ideas now travel across the globe at much greater distances, at much faster speeds, and in much greater volume. People at one time, people like Benjamin Barber, assumed that globalization would create a kind of secular cosmopolitanism, that people would abandon their particularity, their religious backgrounds, and become part of a kind of secular cosmopolitan culture. That hasn't happened. As transnational actors, not confined to any single state, religious actors are in fact able to harness the new technologies and innovations and forces of globalization to spread their message and mobilize their followers and project their influence across national boundaries. Third major trend is democratization, which took off in the early 1970s. more than half of the world easily was under authoritarian or totalitarian rule up until the early 1970s. But starting in the early 1970s, a wave of democratization began to occur. And it's clear now that in contrast to many authoritarian regimes that were sometimes self-proclaimed enemies of God, which sought to eradicate or subjugate religious actors, democracies usually gave religious actors at least some room to enter politics and compete for influence. And as the norms and practices of democracy spread, religious actors and religious parties, organizations were often seen as trusted authorities who could challenge repressive political orders and build social justice. But this takes us to the big question. Is, for example, the Muslim Brotherhood's greater civic role in a more open Egypt to be feared or welcomed? Two factors, we argue, are critical in order to arrive at an answer. The first is the political theology that religious actors espouse. Does this political theology include the need or right to challenge political authority? If yes, does the group's political theology make it legitimate to challenge that authority with violence? In other words, the ideational content of the religious actor and its major ideas are very important. The second critical factor is the freedom that religious actors enjoy, the institutional space that religious actors enjoy vis-a-vis state authority. Religious actors with some semblance of independence and freedom have been able to play liberal, peaceful, and accommodating roles, both advancing democracy and building peace in conflict-ridden societies. In fact, despite the widespread fears of a fundamentalist menace, what we found striking in writing God's Century is how frequently religion and religious mobilization have been a forceful instrument in tearing down dictatorships and authoritarian regimes in the past 40 years. In particular, we argue and we found, based on a systematic analysis of all cases of global political democratization between 1972 and 2009, we found that in the 78 global cases of political liberalization, or democratization loosely defined, religion has contributed strongly in 48 of these cases. Let me say that again. Religious actors have contributed to 48 of 78 cases of global political liberalization. More than 60% of all cases of the world's democratic progress have involved religion playing a significant role. There are lots of examples. You may remember Pope John Paul II's pilgrimages to communist Poland beginning in 1979, where he preached to hundreds of thousands. But this was not just any old homily. Rather, in terms that were unmistakable to Poles, he challenged the legitimacy of the regime. There were Protestants who gathered in Leipzig in November 1989 who played an important role in opposing the regime there. There were Muslim leaders in Indonesia who helped to bring down Suharto in 1998. None of this was supposed to happen. It wasn't supposed to happen according to the secularization paradigm of the normal political science in which we were raised. And it was not supposed to happen according to the fundamentalist paradigm, which was a kind of a successor to the secularization paradigm, which arose to address the increasingly undeniable anomaly that religion wasn't dead after all. And this fundamentalism paradigm essentially said, well, if religion wasn't dead, wherever it survived, it was scary and dangerous and irrational. It was merely a kind of reaction against the forces of modernization and deriving its power, as it were, from the power of modernization pressing against it. Democracy, with its open debate and its popular control, was supposed to have exposed religion as a crutch for a primitive people. Or democracy was supposed to be something that fundamentalists were reacting against and wanted to overthrow. Surprisingly, though, religion has profited precisely from the open debate and room to operate that democracy affords. Looking over the long history of the godless century, the 20th century, and comparing it to God's century today, the present 21st century, it's hard to resist the conclusion that the most aggressively secularizing and secularist movements, regimes, and ideologies were profoundly anti-democratic and pro-authoritarian. Meanwhile, some of the most politically active, assertive, and mobilizing religious movements have been pro-democratic and anti-authoritarian. Of course, religious actors are not always supporters of democracy, far from it. Catholics in Rwanda were acquiescent and even involved in genocide there in 1994. So what distinguishes the democratizers from the supporters of authoritarianism or genocide or terrorism? The most forceful democratizers have been those religious actors who often, through determined resistance, preserved a measure of independence from the state, regardless of their religious tradition or background. An example is the major Islamic movements under Suharto in Indonesia, where religious actors remained cozy with the state, where they were co-opted by the state or in cahoots with the state. They had little incentive to support democracy. Examples include the Argentine Catholic Church in the late 1970s and the Buddhist Sangha in Sri Lanka. In other cases, religious actors are so suppressed by the state that they simply lack power to act independently. The Orthodox churches in the Soviet Union and communist Eastern Europe are illustrative. We also found that religious actors who agitate for democracy are ones whose doctrines involve a political theology that supports democracy and human rights. A striking trend was what the late Samuel Huntington called the Catholic wave, the preponderant role of the Catholic Church in the third wave of democratization between 1974 and the early 1990s. National Catholic churches constituted 36 out of the 48 cases of religious democratizers in our research. What motored this trend, we argue, was an important shift in political theology, namely a full embrace of religious freedom and other human rights by the church at the Second Vatican Council of 1962 to 1965. As for Islam, it's undeniable that democracy, full democracy, is still relatively rare. Only 3 out of 47 Muslim countries are ranked fully free by Freedom House. Still, Islam has had strong democratizers in places like Turkey and Indonesia, movements with independence from the state and with democratic political theology, the two factors we argue are crucial. It is such movements that we believe hold great promise for the future and for the rest of God's century. Monica?
So Tim's gone over sort of the upsides of religion, the resurgence of religion, and in the book we offer sort of a theory which is, you know, is contingent on those two factors, the political theology and the independence of religious actors and the state from one another. And we have four important empirical chapters. So two of the chapters look at sort of the violent side of things, civil wars and terrorism, and two of the chapters look at sort of the upside of the positive influences of religion, democratization and peace and reconciliation. And Tim's already talked about the democratization piece. Can you just go to the next slide? So Freedom House data, if you look, the good news is that globally speaking, the world is becoming more open, transparent, governments are becoming more accountable to their populations. But there are still a large number of autocracies and anocracies. Anocracies are sort of in between. We do see an opening up, but we also do see autocracy and anocracy. And it turns out that religious actors, as Tim said in the democratization piece, have been involved in propelling democratization forward, but they've also been involved in pushing it back. And one of the findings from the political science literature is that the process of democratization itself is wrought with violence. So it's that transition. It's a real policy conundrum. How do you go from an autocracy to a democracy when we know that that in-between state, the anocracy state, is prone with violence? And in some cases, religion and religious actors are implicated. So part of the surprise when we were writing the book was that it was a forceful instrument in tearing down dictatorships. So that chart, when you're looking at the increase, religious actors were there promoting democracy and mediating peace and healing the wounds of war, but they've also been implicated in violence. And where religion is a source of violence, again, it results from the same factors that explain democracy and peace. And as I said, the degree of independence of the state and the political theology of the actors. You actually have to look at what the actors, the beliefs behind their behavior, what are they doing? In the case of violence, these variables take on readings that are the opposite of those that lead to more peaceful outcomes. First, religious actors are likely to become the source of civil war and terrorism when they inhabit states with a close integration of state and religion. So you have the state and church or state and religious actors married, and where there's particularly a dominant religious group that's being favored by the state. And this typically leads to the marginalization of dissenting minority religious groups who then lobby. They don't have an outlet, so then they lobby through violence. This pattern has been quite common in the Arab world since World War II, as in the case of Egypt, from Nasser's officer coup in 52 up until the recent overthrow of Mubarak. People thought the Muslim Brotherhood was dead. It was not. It was just pushed underground and also, of course, into prisons. So a government that is secular in spirit typically allies closely with a dominant faction of Islam, usually a moderate one, and then marginalizes more traditional groups. And we spend a good amount of time looking at Al-Qaeda, which sort of emerged out of local politics within Arab states, and then it became global. Second, religious actors carry political theologies that lead to violence. So we're not saying that all political theologies are bad, but if a political theology advocates violence, which some do, then chances are you're going to get violence. Why it's very important, look at what the political actors, the religious actors who are acting politically, are saying they're going to do, and then is it consistent? On the basis of their understandings, not our understanding, their understandings of their very doctrines, they advocate a state where they will enjoy close integration with the ruling regime and thereby threaten other religious groups. They want a privileged position, and if they think that it's within their right to use violence to protect that privileged position, chances are they're going to do that. It's really striking how few policymakers actually trust that groups are going to do what they say they're going to do. Read their manifestos. This marginalization leads to a backlash of violence, or quite simply, they hold doctrines that sanction violence for their cause. If we look at civil wars, I'm a student of civil wars since 1940, 42 of 133, so this was the data for SIM. If you look, one of our arguments is that this global resurgence of religion started in the 1970s. That's when democratization really took off. Sam Huntington called it the third wave of democratization, and Catholic actors were largely involved in that, in particular in Latin America. But you also see at the same time an increase in civil wars, and again, it's this process of democratization where the government is sort of up for grabs, and in some cases, violence emerges. And if you look at the proportion, if you look at the character of civil wars, what are people fighting over? The proportion of civil wars after 1970 took on a religious tint, more so than it did earlier. Didn't begin in 2000, didn't begin in 1990, it began in the 1970s. Religious civil wars today make up about half of ongoing civil wars. In many, religion is peripheral, meaning that the actors just identify with different faith traditions. They are not fighting to have religion be central, a particular variant of religion be central. One of the big debates about the wars in former Yugoslavia, and most of you are too young, shockingly, to remember these and these debates. They happened in the 1990s. Many of you were children, but a big debate was the degree to which it was Orthodox Serbs fighting Catholic Croats fighting Bosnian Muslims. Or was it Bosnians, Croats, and Serbs fighting each other? How central was religion? And that debate actually in scholarly circles is still being debated. Some people say it was absolutely central. Other people say it was peripheral because the Catholic Croats weren't asking, you know, to have Rome determine some of their policies. In any event, sometimes religion is peripheral, but in other cases it's central, and we can think about the Taliban fight today in Afghanistan that we've been witnessing for the last two decades. They really do want to have a strict interpretation of Sharia law throughout the lands of Afghanistan. Similarly, Sudan. The first war from 56 to 72, it was largely peripheral. It was a fight of self-determination and greater autonomy. Yes, the South was predominantly non-Muslim. They were Christian and animist. The North predominantly Muslim, Arab. And really, the South was just fighting for greater representation, greater rights within this broader state of Sudan. That changed in the 1980s when the North started imposing Sharia law throughout all the lands of Sudan, including on the predominantly non-Muslim South. And that's when the Southern Sudanese said, wait a second, and they pushed back. Religion was much more central in that war, and today we have two states as a result of it. And this is critical for understanding because civil wars that have a religious bend to them, they tend to last longer, they're more deadly, and non-combatants, there seems to be sort of a taking off of the gloves in the fight. So they're more deadly to non-combatants, and tragically, they tend to recur more often. So once the war ends, the chances that war, think about Afghanistan today, that war is more likely to recur. It's the same combatants, same motives, and religion tends to intensify. Another case that's paradigmatic is the Caucasus in Chechnya. The first war, again, as in Sudan, was largely a self-determination struggle. Second time around, no, religion took on a greater tint, in part because religious ideas help to motivate people to accept that self-sacrifice and martyrdom for the cause is more acceptable. It also turns out that religion tends to disproportionately, in civil wars, involve Islam. In upwards of 80% of civil wars, Islamic groups have been one or both of the combatants. So you have fellow Muslims disagreeing with each other about the role of religion and going to war over that, Tajikistan at the end of the Soviet Union, where you had former communist secular actors really fighting to have a secular state up against fighters who had a more religious tint, wanted more Sharia law. Or you have Christians versus Muslims, and we're seeing this really ramp up. It's been for some time in Nigeria, where you have Christians versus Muslims. In 58% of these wars, the third of all civil wars since 1940, the states involved have Islam as a dominant religion. And we think part of the reason is that many Muslim societies are going through this process of democratization. Again, it's part of these broader global trends that we're pointing to. And so we think this occurs in two patterns, why and how the civil wars emerge. The first is found in secular integralist states built on nationalism and modernization, as in the Arab world. Again, the pattern is the government allies with a modern Islamic group and marginalizes conservative Islam. This is what happened in Saudi Arabia. Although it didn't have a civil war, it spawned groups that we're dealing with today. The case that we talk about in the book is Algeria, where you had a war that broke out in the early 1990s and brought about the deaths, most people don't realize this, of 200,000 people. It was a vicious civil war. The post-colonial government in Algeria was a socialist dictatorship dedicated to building an Algeria based on equality, loyalty to the nation, and importantly, secularism, right? Many Algerian elites were educated in the West, and so they come back and they bring their secularist ideologies with them. They promoted an official, moderate version of Islam and suppressed traditional forms. And they expected the, you know, Islam to sort of fade away out of the public arena. It didn't. In the 1970s, Islamic beliefs and traditions resurged among the population, and by the mid-1980s, amid an economic crisis that accentuated the corruption and poor economic performance of the regime, the Islamists threatened an electoral victory, an open democratic election, and they almost won it. And they won the first round of the national elections. The problem is the regime didn't let them have it, and the army stepped in and canceled those elections, touching off a decade of massive bloodshed. Who's responsible there? The Islamists? The population who wants more Islam in the public arena? Or the government? The second factor is the growth of radical Islamic revivalism and its capture of some regimes. The belief that Islam has gone into decline and a radical revival is needed has resulted in calls for a strong form of Sharia law. And again, we saw this in Sudan, that sometimes threatens minorities, and not such small minorities. And again, I've already talked about Sudan, but we saw a similar thing in Sri Lanka, where the Buddhist Sangha's exclusion of Tamils resulted in civil war, which was just ended after decades, 16, 18 months ago. So religious, just as civil wars, the proportion of civil wars with a religious tint has been on the rise, so has religiously inspired terrorism. Prior to the 1980s, religious terrorist actions or activities were practically non-existent. It just didn't exist. It was largely, we can think about the Baader-Meinhof brigades. There was a lot of leftist and sort of right-wing terrorism. You can think about Breivik today. He's actually parodied in Anders Behring Breivik, the Norwegian, what do we want to call him, criminal terrorist. I mean, he's sort of a transnational cosmopolitan. He's a xenophobe. He's a racist. He actually sort of fits into the 1970s, 1980s paradigm, not what we're thinking about today. After the 1980s, the numbers changed, though, and increased proportionally from the 80s, 90s, and into this century. In 1980, 4% of known international terrorist organizations had a religious basis. Only 4%. That's really small. However, by 1994, it was a third, 33%, and then 46% in 1995, and then into 2004. And this is Bruce Hoffman's data, who's done a nice job cataloging this. Again, as with civil wars, which are more deadly, last longer, tend to recur, are less amenable to negotiation, religiously inspired terrorism is more deadly than secular terrorism. While attacks of secular groups tend to kill on average 3 to 4 people and wound another 8 to 16, religious terrorists tend to kill 17 people per attack, 5 times as more deadly, and wound another 39. Since 2011, Salafi jihadist groups, this is Asaf Mahagadam's data, have been responsible for the largest number of terrorist missions and proportion of deaths. Not only do such groups support the spread of Islam through violence, jihad, we all know this term, but of course we know from Islam that jihad has multiple meanings, but they give a violent interpretation, and this is important. They give a particular interpretation to jihad as an elevated status and a permanent individual obligation to fight for the faith externally. Additionally, the excommunication or takfir of other Muslims, fellow Muslims, is practiced strongly, while suicide attacks and targeting of civilians is justified. It's not that it's uncontested, but they do come up with a political theology that justifies it. So as transnational actors, these jihadis have managed to escape the confines of state boundaries. Historically, they tended to be local fighters, fighting local battles, but by the 1980s, especially after the defeat of the Soviet Union, which was incredibly important, this is a nuclear-armed superpower that was defeated by these jihadis, religious terrorism became a global phenomenon, or more precisely, what we term it in the book, a global one. So it started with local dynamics, but then became global. So local issues linked to global ones, and it continues today. So this can be seen in the case of foreign fighters who often uninvited spontaneously joined fights to defend fellow Muslims. Again, the wars in former Yugoslavia, Chechnya, Afghanistan. The reorientation of U.S. foreign policy in the last two decades to Afghanistan and fighting al-Qaeda is a result of religiously inspired violence that continues today. And again, the explanation is similar. Such violence occurs due to Islamic revivalism and the marginalization of Islamists by a highly secularized regime. So, but, you know, Tim's already given you a side of religion that's not violent. Another side is about religion actually promoting peace and reconciliation. So I'm going to turn to that now. So every religion, it turns out, has a peace tradition. And every religion inspiring activists who can be found hard, working hard for peace. And one of my favorite books when I teach at the Kennedy School is Scott Appleby's book called The Ambivalence of the Sacred. It's a terrific book. The only problem at this point is it was published in 1999, which is amazing because it's prior to 9/11 and our concern with this. And he talks about militants, religious militants. When he uses that terminology, he's talking about religious militants and what we think about. In terms of using violence, but he also talked about militants for peace. And it turns out that in studying civil wars, that many religious actors have been responsible for bringing peace and transitional justice to societies that just succumb to large levels of violence. And so how they do that, the peace-building work, you can think about it in two contexts. The first is mediation itself. So during the past half century, the preponderance in violence in the world has taken place in civil wars, not in interstate wars. And the vast majority of killing, upwards of 16 million people have died as a result of civil wars. And if you look at how civil wars are ending in the current era, most of them are ending through negotiation. So who's negotiating ends to these wars? It turns out religious actors actually are involved in a lot of them. We surveyed 26 cases of peace negotiations since the end of the Cold War, and find that in 11 of these cases, religious actors played a strong mediating role. And what we mean by that is that peace probably would not have come had they not been there. That's a pretty strong claim. In 11 of these cases, they played a weak mediating role. So peace may or may not have come, but the religious actors sort of helped propel it forward. In only 4 cases, they played no significant role. So again, really, really important dynamic that was being missed. What characterized the effective mediators? Independence, again, mattered a great deal, but here it's with respect to the state and the armed combatants, because we're looking at, you know, at a different kind of political dynamic and different groupings. So a political theology that placed a special stress on peace was essential, and perhaps the quintessential religious negotiator has been the community of Sant'Egidio. I don't know if you've heard this. They were actually involved in the Libyan, trying to get people to talk in Libya and mediate an end to that. It's a lay community of the Catholic Church, and through befriending parties on all sides, their core mission is actually developing friendships and trust and embedding themselves within society so that when the moment emerges where there's a possibility of peace, they're there to do it. So in Mozambique, they were responsible for bringing peace to Mozambique over 16 years. They affiliated with no one in particular. They were friends with the government and with the rebels. And through the community's political theology of peace and reconciliation, friendship, and embeddedness within the society, it was able to bring all the parties to the negotiating table and bring about peace in 1992. And it has served as a key negotiator in Algeria, Guatemala, Liberia, Burundi, and most recently in Libya. We also surveyed 19 cases of transitional justice, that is, countries' choices about how to deal with past crimes, right? after a transition to peace or democracy. And common approaches include punitive justice, epitomized by the International Criminal Court, and truth recovery, the most famous of which, of course, is the South African Peace Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And we found that in 8 of these cases, religious actors were importantly influential. In all of these cases, they favored truth recovery, though in a few cases, they also favored trials, punitive, right, holding people, individuals responsible, putting them in jail. And the signature, so if we think about South Africa again, the signature actor was the Anglican Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who had been both a leader in the anti-apartheid movement and a pioneering theologian of reconciliation. And in fact, our co-author, Dan, goes to great lengths to show how these concepts of forgiveness, reconciliation, they're embedded in religious ideas, and that we wouldn't have them had it not been for religion. And then following South Africa's transition to democracy in 94, he rose to lead the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. So I'm just going to summarize up this part and then get to some lessons to conclude. Religion has made a political comeback. We do agree for 50 years these secular regimes did suppress it. It was largely a private matter. After the 1970s, aided and abetted by globalization, the movement toward democracy, and also the failure of modern regimes, modernization, the failure of them to provide basic needs of populations, compelled people to challenge states compelled religious actors to get into the forefront of that. Those religious actors who are most closely integrated with state authority and hold a political theology that calls for state sponsorship and the subordination of minorities and the use of violence are most likely to be violent. Those who have remained independent of state authority and carry political theology that prescribes democracy, peace, and reconciliation are most likely to be peaceful and democratic and help advance liberalization. All right, so the lessons for U.S. foreign policy today. So first, quite simply, it's essential that foreign policymakers come to understand religion better. Ignorance is not bliss. We missed the Iranian Revolution. We're terrified about the Muslim Brotherhood. We don't know what's going to happen in Libya. It's time to start to really get behind this. Second, better understanding the forces that shape the politics of religion can help the U.S. pursue its goals of democratization. I mean, I think one of the important aspects, if Tim puts that other chart up, is that they've been central. In the United States, one of the pillars of U.S. foreign policy is democratization, or opening up regimes, human rights protection. Religious actors are there. They're a friend. They're not a foe. The U.S. Should better know which religious actors are likely to support these goals, which are likely to be allies, and which are likely to stand in the way. Some unabashedly universalistic claims can be derived from this argument as well. Namely, where government and religion lack institutional independence, the result is likely to be conflict. So they need to be independent of one another and not be cozy in bed. Whereas independence is a precondition for democracy and a mediating influence. They don't need to be contained. Religious actors don't need to be put into a box. Thus, it seems that a healthy institutional independence between religion and state is good for everyone, everywhere. This carries with it an important lesson for policy. While it does not mean that the U.S. ought to replicate exactly the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, it does mean that a healthy secularism of separation is better for democracy, human rights and peace on one hand, and for the flourishing of religion on the other. And we're very strong about this in the book, that you have two options. You can include religious actors and bring them into the fold, or you can exclude them, and the chances are if you exclude them, you're going to have problems down the road. Religious actors cannot be confined to a private sphere. Survey after survey, you can look at the World Values Survey, Africa Barometer, more and more populations want religion in the public sphere. They want their politicians to exude religious beliefs, to act on them. And we, therefore, should not act to keep them there. So today, again, the biggest question in Egyptian politics is the place of the Muslim Brotherhood. The Brotherhood is a complex organization with many factions. Some of you are more expert than we are, and its future is not without risks. But it is far more likely to be peaceful and democratic precisely if it's brought into the fold of Egyptian democracy rather than being marginalized. In Egypt, they warn the Muslim Brotherhood will overtake the young secular activists who bravely brought down dictator Hosni Mubarak. In Syria, they have claimed Bashar al-Assad's dictatorship may be brutal, but it is a lesser evil than a Sunni majority that will oppress Christians, Shiites, and women. Such anxiety plays perfectly into the ruling rationale of the regime's secular sultans, who have resisted popular governance with the argument that it spells theocracy. And the data show that actually when, in particular in Muslim societies, when Islamic parties have to compete, they moderate their position. So this reflexive fear of politically active religious groups is rooted in ideology of secularism that persists among elite academic foreign policymakers and within the academy. Some of our colleagues are now writing about how it is that the academy has missed this. We can understand some foreign policymakers, because the U.S. Constitution, there's a lot of debate about whether religion can be privileged not only at home, but abroad in our foreign policymaking. If secularism means a healthy distinction between religious and political authority, it is essential to democracy. And Pope Benedict called this positive secularism. Negative secularism, by contrast, presumes that religion is irrational, pre-modern, violent, and headed for extinction, and has no place in democratic politics. Negative secularism mistakenly equates religious participation with religious takeover and the subversion of democracy. Its answer to theocracy is secularocracy, the absolute supremacy of non-religious principles in politics. So pro-government forces in Syria illustrated this sort of attitude most recently in Hama, after they crushed the protest there. They scrawled on the walls of the city such slogans as, "No God but Al-Assad," "God falls down and Assad lives." During the Cold War, this negative secularism undergirded America's policy in the Middle East. And it was an overriding concern for us finding reliable allies against the Soviets. In only a few cases were our allies highly religious, that is in Saudi Arabia and Pakistan. Far more often, they were regimes built on nationalism, economic and social modernization, and the secular containment of grassroots Islam. So from Tangiers to Tehran, such regimes sought to control Islam by marginalizing, privatizing, and sharply regulating it. And they gave financial and legal support to approved moderate Muslims, and then they jailed and tortured traditional dissident Muslims. When Western liberals questioned why Mubarak imprisoned 20,000 of his Egyptian citizens, Mubarak, playing right into American hands, said, "It's either me or the Muslim Brotherhood." The U.S. bought the argument, and such thinking partly explains why the Obama administration was slow to abandon him, right? Only days before his downfall, according to New Yorker's Ryan Liza, a White House official summarized Mubarak's message to the U.S., and what do you think it was? "Muslim Brotherhood, Muslim Brotherhood, Muslim Brotherhood." In the end, however, America's policy of promoting secular dictatorships has simultaneously undermined democracy and stability and bolstered religious radicals. Instead, the United States will best advance its long-term interests by encouraging the Middle East transitioning regimes to invite all nonviolent. We're not saying if a group has a violent political theology, they should be brought into the political arena. Absolutely not. The first condition is they have to renounce violence, which the Muslim Brotherhood has done, into the political arena. And then you will get a moderating effect. Look at the BJP in India, which Tim's an expert on. They've actually moderated their position since being part of the political arena. So I'm going to just conclude to say that religion is far from being the only or even the most decisive. We've been giving you lots of religion, a lot of faith here. But it's an integral and an important one. And so in the book, we're trying to highlight both the good, but of course the bad. And when we were writing this book, we're like, everybody's just going to read the Civil War and terrorism chapter, right? That's what they care about. But we think actually two of the most important chapters is the democracy chapter and the peace and reconciliation. But the truth is, you can't understand all four unless you read them together and understand how they interrelate and interact. The 21st century, God century, has brought us a world radically different from one that the secularization paradigm promised, or one that the fundamentalism paradigm threatened and continues to threaten. I mean, with Mubarak, the Muslim, you know, his statement. And one that is a lot more complex. And I think that's one of the issues when you have to study religion and political theologies, right, of different faiths. It is actually a daunting task, but it really needs to be done. And we argue that you have no choice, but we have to build new theories and devise fresh policy strategies for the religious age that we live in and have lived in, not for the secular age that never came or that really never was. So I'll conclude there.
Thank you very much.